Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who brings us together this morning to welcome all that here are here or at home, wherever you are in your life, as we begin our worship this day. Before we start, we'll have a few announcements on the back of your bulletin. You'll see a few. Some of them are what we plan, and some of them are not necessarily when they're going to happen. But so today, there'll be a brief meeting after worship for our fundraiser, the barbecue and raffle, and et cetera. Monday's Bible study at 10 a.m. Session may be moved to Tuesday at 7 p.m. And Wednesday's crafters meeting at 3 p.m. And just as you noted in your bulletin today, your package, there's the Pentecost offering that the Presbyterian Church puts out. And there'll be a second offering next Sunday for that. Are there any other announcements that need to be made?
Morning.
Good morning.
Just to add a little bit more about the Pentecost offering. This offering is completely geared towards youth, both in our community, in our country, and throughout the world. And so if you have a minute, I invite you to take a look through the pamphlet. But 40% of this has the potential to stay within our own congregation for needs of the youth in our own community. 25% of it supports young adult volunteers throughout our denomination. 25% ministries of the youth, including Presbyterian Triennium, which is a large gathering of the youth every 3 years in a central location in the U.S. And 10% is devoted to children at risk to improve education and provide safe havens for them. So this is just a strong advocation for what a great second offering this is for every nomination, because it is completely, completely devoted to the youth. And so just to let you know that. Crafters have been busy, and we do have a few projects that people want to take home. As some noticed, there's a box of bottles. The labels need to come off of them, so if anybody wants to take some bottles home and help get labels off, there's a box of old insulators that need to be cleaned up a little bit. We have one more no-sew blanket, and then we have a few ties that we just need the seams ripped out on a few of them. So if anybody willing to help with any of those easier projects, you can please let me know.
Any other announcements? Then let us turn to the call to worship this morning. Well, actually, we'll start with the musical introit, which is "Jesus Shall Reign Where'er the Sun." Continue with the prayer of praise and adoration. God of resurrection, we are grateful that the new life you have promised through Jesus Christ is made known to us now. We rejoice that we are resurrected. places with the worldly life of our own making. But you are the creator of heaven and earth. We rejoice because you are the one who made us and makes us new. Help us to leave behind the ways of this world and live in your ways of restoration, love, justice, mercy, and peace. Amen and amen. Our first hymn is Come, Christians Join to Sing. Come to the point of service for calling to our confession. Let us confess our sins to the one who is always ready to forgive with grace upon grace upon grace. Let us pray. Creator God, we confess that we are times are struck. We are unable to move forward and only we wonder, where are you leading us? As it seems, we are alone. Help us to become unstuck. Help us to move by faith, to trust that you are with us, guiding us along the way. Call us to your ways. Encourage us to live with hope instead of approach. Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, help us in this journey of life and faith, now and always. Amen. Hear these words of assurance from the book of Philippians. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Know that the peace of God is with you. You are loved by God. Sink into that knowledge and allow God's wisdom and insight to fill your mind so that you might live into faith. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
book of John, the 17th chapter, first 11 verses. And this, we celebrate this Sunday as the Ascension Sunday, as Jesus prepares to leave his disciples. He gives last words of instruction, giving us encouragement to continue on even through this day. Let us hear the words of God. When Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify thy Son, that the Son may glorify thee, since thou hast given him power over all flesh, to give eternal life to all whom thou hast given him. And this is eternal life, that they know the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I glorify thee on earth, having accomplished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, Father, glorify thou me in thy own presence with the glory which I had with thee before the world was made. I have manifest thy name to the men whom thou hast given me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them to me, and they have kept thy word. Now they know that everything that thou hast given me is from thee, for I have given them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them and know in truth that I come from thee. And they have believed that thou didst send me. I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom thou hast given me, for they are thine. All mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to thee. Holy Father, keep them in thy name, which thou hast given me, that they may be one, even as we are one." Here ends the reading of our morning scripture, first lesson.
He had said this as they were watching, going, and they were gazing up toward heaven. Suddenly, two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." This is the word of our Lord, and we give our thanks and praise. Let us pray. Merciful God, we ask your Spirit to fall upon us now, that it may stir in us in the hearing and proclaiming of your word, that we might be renewed in mind, body, and spirit, and go from this place built up into the body that you call us to be. It's in Christ our Lord name we pray. Amen. During the Second Great Awakening, a religious movement in our country in the 19th century, a man by the name of William Miller began preaching the Adventist movement. That is, preaching on Christ's second coming. After converting to being a Baptist in the 1820s, Miller started studying the prophetic books of Daniel and Revelation, concluding that Christ would return around the year 1843, eventually narrowing it down between March 21st, 1843 and March 21st, 1844. And while a comet came particularly close to Earth and gave people a false sense of hope, March 21st came and went, 1844, and there was no return of Christ. New dates were thrown out, April 3rd, April 18th, and finally in August, a follower of Miller, a man named Samuel Snow, predicted a new calculation, October 22nd, 1844. While many had been disappointed and doubted from experiences with this new calculation, there was a renewed sense of energy and excitement. On this new predicted night, thousands from across the country gathered in churches and on hilltops wearing white ascension robes in anticipation of meeting Christ. Taking it all a step further in how they lived and waited in that year of between March 21st, 1843 and March 21st, 1844, many had sold all their possessions or gave everything they had away, completely getting rid of anything that connected them to this world. And so when the sun came up on October 23, the world had not ended, Christ had not returned, it delivered a crushing blow to so many, a date now known as the Great Disappointment. And really though, we think about it, nobody should have been surprised or disappointed. Several times throughout the Gospels, Jesus makes it clear no one knows the day or the time except the Father. And here, even in our Acts reading this morning, Jesus tells the disciples, after they ask specifically, "Is this the time the Lord will restore the kingdom to Israel?" Jesus tells them, "It's not for you to know the times or the periods that the Father has set by his own authority." Jesus goes on to tell them instead, "You will receive the power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You will be my witnesses to Jerusalem, all of Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." Making it clear one more final time before he leaves, only the Father knows, no one else, not him, not the angels, no one but the Father. And yet so many have gotten so distracted by trying to determine the end times, Jesus' second coming. Not just Miller or Snow, but as recently in 2011 by Harold Camping. And even the disciples had gotten distracted by this a number of times. This question that they ask right before Jesus ascends. And so here they are, though, left standing gazing up into heaven after Jesus' ascension. Maybe left wondering when he will return. Already distracted, and Jesus hasn't even begun 5 minutes. And who knows how long they stood gazing up. Maybe it was a while before these two men in white robes come by and stand next to them. Now, men in white robes are typically symbolic of the divine, possibly angels, but definitely a messenger or a sign from God. And they ask, why do you stand looking up? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way that you saw him go into heaven. Why are you just standing there? It's a good question. For Jesus just commanded the disciples to be witnesses. Yes, they're to wait for the Holy Spirit to come upon them, but they're to wait in Jerusalem. Right now, they're standing outside of Jerusalem on the Mount of Olives. They're just standing there, so easily distracted. Just as Miller was easily distracted by determining the second coming, as thousands were easily distracted on those hilltops, and perhaps as we are easily distracted today. Perhaps our distraction isn't gazing up into the sky after seeing Christ descend, or our distraction isn't sitting on a hilltop awaiting his second coming, but we certainly do have distractions. Distractions of how we can get ahead in this world, distractions of our busy lives. In the church, we get distracted by not enough people in the pews or money coming. Distractions over church polity and government. Distractions over the way things were, or that's not how we've always done it. Distractions over feeling like you don't know what to do or say. Anxiety of how to move forward. But Jesus tells his disciples, his followers, he tells us, you will be my witnesses. Not that you might be, not perhaps or maybe. No if or when, but you will be. And to be witnesses to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to Chester, to Orange County, the United States, to all the ends of the world. Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines a witness in a few different ways. Attestation of a fact or event, one that gives evidence, one who testifies in a cause or before a jury. One asked to be present at a transaction so as to be able to testify to its having taken place. One who has personal knowledge of something. As witnesses to Christ, we are to live as ones who have personal knowledge of Christ, of God's love through Christ. Attest to the fact that God loves the world, that through Christ all can come to be saved, to be loved, and renewed and restored. And so we are to live our lives accordingly, constantly pointing to Jesus in all that we do, how we live our lives, the kind of job we have, how we behave at that job, how we treat our neighbors and our families and friends. How we treat those we dislike or who dislike us. How we raise our children or teach others around us. How we support and encourage one another as fellow Christians. How we show and share Christ's love. Yet like the disciples, we so often get distracted by numerous things. We get distracted from being witnesses. From not only living the way God desires us to live, but truly living out being this witness of shining Christ's marvelous light for all the world to see. And often our distractions, unfortunately, also cause divisions. Those followers of Miller were so distracted by the second coming and preparing to wait on hilltops that they didn't realize how divided they had become. And this divides them. Even today, at times, our distractions divide us. The right type of music in worship. Who are you going to vote for? Who can and can't be married in the church? Who should be cared for? Who should be welcomed? Who fits in with the right image? Who gets left out? And in these divisions, we begin to lose our credible witness. We begin to be so distracted and so divided that we don't realize we are sending, we don't realize the message we are sending to the ends of the earth. Not necessarily one of welcome or one that reflects Christ, not one that is filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, but one that shares the love of God. Because of our divisions and distractions. Which is perhaps why Jesus prays for his disciples near the end of John. His first reading this morning is a long passage in the middle of Jesus' farewell to his disciples. Here today we see that Jesus prays for God to keep them and for them to be one, as Jesus is one with the Father. Jesus knew how difficult they would have it once he was gone. He saw over and over again firsthand just how much they got distracted, how often little things caused divisions among them, even when he was standing right there with them. We remember they argued over who would sit at his left and right hand. So Jesus prays that they may not only remain in God's care, but be one with each other. One with Christ, as Jesus says, he has been one with God. And somehow, thankfully, the disciples, the apostles, leaders of the early church are able to do this, to figure it out, to stay united. Continue to be a credible witness even among their distractions and divisions. How they overcome their distractions for the work of the gospel. Philip meets a eunuch on the road who asks what it is to prevent him from being baptized. Philip could have easily called out his sexual identity as a status, and status as a reason to refrain in the Old Testament. Eunuchs weren't allowed to be a part of the spiritual body, but he pauses on the road and baptizes him right then and there. The apostles and leaders of the church could have sent Saul, who has become Paul after his conversion, away for fear that he hasn't truly changed. For he did help stone and persecute many believers before his conversion. But they welcomed him. Peter almost got hung up on food, what was clean and unclean to eat, yet with the help of the divine in the dream, it became clear he nor any other believer should be hung up on what to eat or not eat, especially among the Gentiles. When the Jerusalem Council met, they argued over the need for believers to be circumcised, the heated debate that they did eventually end with the agreement that all are welcome, regardless of their status. That there are no requirements to be a believer. Women are converted and their houses used to start house churches, with those women potentially being leaders themselves among those who meet in their houses. It is continually made clear throughout the book of Acts not to block anyone from further relationship in Christ. Even if we don't agree with their lifestyle, their food, their culture, their gender, their previous religion, that we shouldn't get distracted by these things or let them divide the church. Jesus opens the door for all. If we trust and believe he has now ascended and sits on the right hand of God, we will continue to live lives that point to this, witness to the love of God in Christ Jesus. We are to remain united, not necessarily always agreeing on everything, not necessarily all the same, not uniform, but united, one in Christ. seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, we are to be witnesses to this truth, united as one as we spread the message near and far, far and wide, here, there, and everywhere. Amen. Turn to the affirmation of faith that can be found printed in the bulletin this morning. It is adapted from 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 11. Together, let us affirm our faith. This is the good news.
Suffers from many ongoing health issues.
lift up prayers for Jean, prayers for healing and recovery. We lift up prayers, especially that the doctors are able to determine the ongoing issues and develop a better plan for healing and recovery. So we trust this care and the guidance and discernment of the doctors to our Lord. Continue with a time of silent prayer as we lift up prayers on our hearts. Christ prays on behalf of his disciples. Let us pray on behalf of all those Christ loves. God of grace, the world is full of those who delight in your teachings and those who scoff at your ways. We pray that we might meditate on you day and night, that we might be an influence for good in the world. God of wisdom, the world is full of those whose faith seeks understanding and those who discard the truth. We pray that we might receive your word and know that you are the truth that transforms our lives. God of justice, the world is full of those who seek to do what is right, and those who seek only their own self-interest. We pray for those who protect the innocent and seek to overcome systems that oppress. May we carry your light until all might see your way. God of healing, the world is full of those who are sick, injured, alone, and in need of care, and those who dedicate their lives to caregiving and healing. We pray that your holiness and wholeness will draw near to all those who are in need, that they might be filled with your presence. God of unity, the world is filled with those who claim that they belong to you, and those who actively work against your plans and purposes for a new creation. We pray for reconciliation, courage, and faith for your church, that your followers will be sanctified in the truth, and that we might proclaim the good news of redemption, of great joy, to a world in desperate need of good news. Christ prays on behalf of his disciples. We lift up to you the prayers of our hearts for those we know and love, trusting them to your protection and care. Hear our prayers and give us confidence and courage that we might join our voices together, praying with the words that Christ himself taught his disciples.
saying, "Our Father,
to a time of offering and prayer of dedication. Over and over again, God has not just provided our daily bread, but provides good gifts in abundance, blessings poured out upon us. In response to this great love, with humble and grateful hearts, let us offer up our tithes, gifts, offerings, even offering up our very lives to the Lord. May they be used to provide continued blessings upon our community, country, and world. O God, accept these gifts that we offer as a sign of our faith and commitment to create and all of us also as our world. May these gifts be used to commitment to justice, peace, grace, and the sharing of your shared love for the flourishing. Closing hymn is "We All Are One."
May the Lord lift up his